Hi and welcome once again to Rockin' the Planet. I'm Shane, I'm so glad you could join me tonight to celebrate more of the great wealth of New Zealand talent that we have. This week we get to meet and greet with award-winning trumpeter and vocalist John McGough, with a style all his own. And also joining me will be the amazing musician, singer-songwriter, John Tuala, known to his friends as JT. But first, let's see who's been rocking the planet this week. To follow up on last week's story, AC/DC's frontman Brian Johnson's love of racing cars is what he attributes to his loss of hearing, not music. He's adamant that rock and roll was not solely to blame for his loss of hearing. And while we're on medical matters, ex-bassist for the Rolling Stones, 79-year-old Bill Wyman, he is undergoing treatment still for prostate cancer. We're wishing him a speedy recovery. His bandmate Charlie Watts fully recovered from throat cancer back in 2004. And we wish Bill and Brian a speedy recovery. But now it's time for my first special guest. And he is so talented, a real gentleman. Mr. John Tuala. Man, g'day, how are mate. You? Known to his friends as JT. Hi, JT.
G'day, Shane. There you go,
good
mate.
To see you here, man. Thanks for joining us.
Thanks for having me.
You look so comfortable already. I mean, you've only been here 5 minutes. Look, he's got a wine. He's sitting back, relaxed. Man, can you sing?
Oh, thank you.
I have to say, look, how this evolved that you're here on the show is... we were at a wedding of a good friend of ours, Gordon Joel.
Gordon Joel, yes.
Gordon Joel and the lovely Sue Gray, who's now Mrs. Joel.
Yes, correct.
And what a day in Kaiwaka. And you were up there in the afternoon just playing away, and I was having a champagne and watching, and I thought, this guy, the chords this man's playing. Wow, and everyone was actually complimenting, nudging, hey, he's good. Hey, he's great. And the message went around the whole place, and it was amazing. And I went up to chat to you. And it just so happened, I said, strike while the iron's hot, let's get the man on the show. And here you are. Well, it was that simple.
Well, to be fair, you were in the audience, and so were other famous people. It was probably you inspired me to make sure I did well, because if I didn't, I'd hear all about that too.
You would have got a bad review. You got exactly. A good review, believe me. But a pleasure anyway. Thanks for coming over in such short notice and being here with Rockin' the Planet. Where did you're playing around all the traps and the clubs and all over the place now. Mm-hmm. Where did it all start out for you? You picked up the guitar when you were young?
Yes, seven when I was seven, and you know, being where I grew up, the parents sort of forced you into the music, you know, because being raised in Glen Innes, it wasn't much scope for a future there, so... You took what you could get, as we did, and then I was just forced into music from an early age, and by the time I was 17, I had enough, so I stopped.
So you were there right through to 17, and then you'd stop music?
I just stopped performing on live on stage, and I was performing with bands towards the end, and I just had enough, and then I just did normal things, went to parties and played the guitar, but it's sort of by the age of 30 the passion started to rekindle, the fire started burning, so I got back into it.
So this break, what's 10 years, isn't it?
Yeah.
Really? So what, you were out on the road just, went and got a proper job?
Or? Yeah, I just do normal jobs, because in those days you could walk into one job, walk out of another one and into another one, so you're always
employed. Talking about the late 60s?
A little bit young. 70s to 80s.
Oh, 70s, sorry. You're younger than me. But so around that time, you went out and got a job. And you could just go and get a job, literally change your job in a week and go and get another one down the road.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
So, but the guitar, it must have really yearned. You must have had a big yearning to...
It was always my go-to.
Yeah.
You know, whatever was happening in life, you have the ups and your downs, and it was the go-to. And then by the time I reached 30, I thought, geez, I just really want to start playing again.
Yeah.
So that's how it sort of started, and then from there I am where I am now.
But starting at 30, did you find it hard to get back into the music business?
Yeah, well, that's why I joined an original band, because it was easy. You just make up songs and the chords were easy, but... As the career went on, you just really couldn't do that, you know. So I had to sort of rediscover how to play the guitar.
Yeah, because you must have had some sort of mentor, where someone took you hold you
actually,
and teach you.
I did actually.
A different style.
There's a very renowned guitarist in New Zealand, Tamarenata.
Yes.
And actually, it was around when I was 30. I actually go watch him down at the pubs and clubs, and he sort of inspired me to renewed that passion, and then about 10 odd years later, oh no, probably, I'm not sure about the time frame, I actually met up with him, and we became sort of friends, and then he started mentoring me, and showing me a few chords here and there, and basically just opened up the whole,
extended your knowledge completely,
and also the thirst for knowledge of wanting to learn more.
Opened
chords.
Up a brand new world of
exactly.
chords.
Yeah.
I'm still reading my book of blues chords. You know, trying to learn. But that's fantastic. So is he still around?
Yes, he's still around. Playing with Herbs.
Yeah,
he's playing with Herbs now. Yeah, they do the mini Herbs. It's just him, Dilworth, and Tama London.
Yeah.
But he just, like you said, if you know, the more chords you know, the easier it's going to be able to sing, because, you know, you're not going to try and...
Yeah, sharp and flat and all
that. Yeah, exactly.
You go in the other chord.
Yeah.
Oh, very clever stuff. But that's lovely you got such a good friend, and have you stayed friends all this time?
Yes, we have, yeah.
You haven't ever actually got up and played with Herbs, have you at all?
No, not with Herbs, but I have played with them individually and together in some sort of...
So you mix in that circle
with
all the guys.
Yeah, a bit of jam here and there, you know, so that's quite good.
Now, you've had to make it. You're very fortunate. I believe you're one of the very special musicians in this country that can actually make a living playing music. And it's a very difficult thing, believe me.
Yeah.
Look, no rattles in these pockets. But you have made a living out of music for quite some time.
Yeah, I've been doing it for a while. But it's, there's highs and lows, as I say, with everything in life. Yeah. But just the sheer fact of that I want to play music is why I do it.
Yeah.
And be able to keep playing music and perform live is a win-win situation.
Yeah. Well, personal life, I mean, your mum and dad, were they in the music business?
Yeah, well, they were Pacific Islanders. They migrated here. My mother
actually migrated from
Samoa.
Samoa, yeah.
My mother migrated here just after World War II. My father followed her not long after, and we were baby boomers, Well, I'm the youngest of 14, so...
14?
Yeah, I was an afterthought.
You're the youngest. So you got all the cast-offs all the way.
Yeah. I was just a cast-off.
No,
I'm just kidding. So they were into music. And also, well, I remember growing up as a kid, we listened to the radio, because there was only one radio station back in those days, and all the melodic tunes was what really I gravitated to, Frank Sinatra, all those things going through the 60s, 70s.
Well, that's actually a good cue for me, because Frank Sinatra Jr. has just passed away a week or so ago.
Wow, yes.
From a heart attack, and he was in Florida during the elections. I don't know what went on there, but anyway, he was about to perform at another casino in Florida.
Wow.
And it brings me to the fact that you are actually going to perform a Frank Sinatra song. Were you a big fan of Frank Sinatra?
Oh, yes. I mean, who wasn't? I mean, my mother was, She's Elvis Presley, Frank Sinatra, and then the Rat Pack came along and all that sort of thing.
Yeah, I love Frank Sinatra. I love his music. And his son did a great job, really, not of impersonating him. He had his own style, but he still had that Frank sound, and he made a living out of doing Frank songs. And God bless him, he's gone. But you're going to play us a special song. What is the one you've chosen for us?
It's the Frank Sinatra and his daughter Nancy Sinatra, the duet, saying something stupid.
Something stupid like I love you.
You.
John Tuala, JT to his friends.
I know, stand in line. Do you think you have the time to spend an evening with me? And if we go someplace to dance, and know that there's a chance you won't be leaving with me. Then afterwards we'll stop into a quiet little place and have a drink or two or three. Oh, four. And then I'll go and spoil it all by saying something stupid like I love you. I can see it in your eyes that you despise the same old lines you heard the night before. And though it's just a line to you, to me it's true, it never seemed so right before. I practice every day to find some clever lines that said and made the meaning come true. Then I think I'll wait until the evening gets late and I'm alone with you. The time is right, your perfume fills my head, the stars are red and all the night is blue. And then I'll go and spoil it all but say something stupid like I love you. And then I'll go and spoil it all but say something stupid like I love you. And then I'll go and spoil it all by saying something stupid like I love you.
Something Stupid Like I Love You. And believe me, weren't they great chords? No, they were. John, beautiful.
Thank
beautiful
you,
version of that song.
Thank you.
You're a very talented man, like I've said, and I'm not going to keep on with the accolades all night, so get used to that.
Yeah, stop.
But now, is there something you would have preferred to do, apart from the music thing, if you weren't a musician? Was there some other task you would have taken up in your early life?
Hindsight's a wonderful thing, but I think music was always going to be the calling. I mean, yeah. I did jobs, I was driving trucks, and I was... Yeah. Did a bit of labouring here and all that sort of thing, which I actually liked because I was younger.
It's good fit.
But then I just felt that it wasn't really going anywhere and there was nothing fulfilling in my life.
That's right.
And it was always this thing over here that fulfilled.
This woman?
It. Yeah.
Do you have a name for your guitar?
No, I should. It's about 26 years old. It's we've been together a while. Relationships didn't last long.
Best company you could have, mate. Your musical instrument. Talk back. They do as they're told, and they talk how you tell them to talk.
True. Look, that's
really
sexist stuff.
Look, John, if anyone wants to go and see you play, is there somewhere we can catch up with you on the Auckland music scene wherever you are?
Yes, I have two residencies. One is the Jack Tar on the Wynyard Quarter.
Okay, Jack Tar, remember that, Jack Tar?
Play 6:30 to 9:30 with a saxophonist, Andrew Dixon.
Andrew Dixon.
He plays with Naira Bitria. And then Saturdays I have a solo gig at the Auckland Fish Market.
Fantastic. And time?
12 to 3.
12 in the afternoon.
In the afternoon,
Auckland Fish Market, which is a great place to visit in Auckland.
It is.
Especially in the autumn. Wonderful time.
Right throughout the whole year.
Temperature's not too hot, and you're out there hotting it up. All right, well, look. It's been great having you here, John. I really appreciate
you
coming along.
It's my pleasure.
And, man, we've got to have you back again. Don't worry, all right? Love you. I'll be down to see you at the Wynyard.
You better.
All right. And now it's time for my second very special guest. And I'm really pleased to invite him. He's a multi-award winning man and a multi-instrumentalist. He's an entertainer. That's the word, entertainer. Mr. John McGough.
Shane, wonderful to see you again. How are you? All right?
So good. So good.
Great to be on the show. I've watched it so many times, and it's nice to be here.
You are a trumpeter I guess we call you a trumpeter. I call you an entertainer because you sing as well and you do all sorts of music. Where did it all start for you, John?
Well, my uncle, of course, Neil McGough, was well up with a good trombone player and conductor of the Auckland Philharmonic back many years ago. And my dad played, but my mum got me into playing the trumpet. She was a dance teacher of the then Northern Ballet Company. Mm-hmm. And she was doing a little show out in West Auckland at the Playhouse Theatre. Yep. And they had an orchestra in the pit and there was a guy there playing the trumpet. And she said, "What do you think of that?" And I thought, I wouldn't mind giving that a go. And he was the New Zealand champion at the time, and he gave me lessons, and it all went from there.
Well,
I was about 9 at that stage.
9 years old. Yeah. And what year is that? So I'm trying to work out.
I can't remember now. I'll have to going back, I was never good at maths. I'm a musician. The maths
never
is not too good.
But anyway, so 9 years old. So you basically started training with trumpet at 9 years old.
Yes.
And you went for lessons and things like
that?
Yes,
I did. Yes.
And
so I was brought up in the brass band scene. So, and it evolved from that, really.
Okay,
so,
now that's quite a big thing, isn't it?
It's
quite
huge in New Zealand.
Musicians around doing that brass band.
Yes, yeah, it's a lot. It's big.
And a lot of competition and stuff.
Yeah. And the thing about the brass bands, what I love is there's no age limit. You know, like sport, you know, you can play netball or rugby, you've got to retire at a certain age. You know, same with being an entertainer, you know, you can keep doing it for you know, years to come. And the brass bands have a lot of young kids and the older ones working together. So I love it. It's good fun.
Through the years.
That's
right. Yeah. No, it's a great thing. And so you moved on from brass bands, obviously, and the entertainment thing got you. You must have moved into entertainment. How did that sort of transformation?
Well, that's an interesting story. I
arrive.
Gentleman by the name of Keith Leggett, you'd know Keith. He was a producer at the TV at the time, and he ran a program for young entertainers that he felt might move on and get into the industry. And there were singers and magicians and myself.
He encouraged so many musicians.
It was wonderful. And he was, of course... in the Black and White Minstrels years ago.
And he came out from England and settled here.
That's right. So, and then I started, got my first show. He said, "You're going to do a half hour support act to Rhonda Byers." at the Auckland Leagues Club back then, and I didn't know what I was doing. There was a full band, and I just went in and did it, and I asked, could I have the music in front of me? He said, no, you can't, so I had to learn music, and it all started from
this
there.
This was just playing the trumpet then?
With the backing band, yeah, it was great.
So did you have inspiration, like we mentioned when we were talking in the green room earlier, people like Eddie Calvert, the man with the golden trumpet, and Herb Alpert, and those sort of people that did make a huge living just out of playing trumpet,
Yeah, wonderful entertainer. Yeah. And they were entertainers
but
too,
weren't
they?
They did learn to entertain.
That's right. I'm a big fan of Herb Alpert and do a lot of Herb Alpert numbers in my show.
Right.
And I've also worked with a guy by the name of James Morrison, who's one of the very well-known trumpet players out of Australia.
Yes.
And I've hosted his shows
over there
here in New Zealand. Yeah. So that's been a lot of fun as well.
Now, you have done a lot of travelling out of the country as well, haven't you?
Yes,
I know that you're, like I said, award-winning. Did you win some awards in Asia?
No, I've not in Asia. I have here, but I do work for a promotions company, and we take people over to Asia to trips, and I've played in conferences over there, and then we also take groups up to the Great Wall of China and up into the mountains, and I play What a Wonderful World in Pokarikariana, and they just get a taste of home,
and they
love
it. Great Wall of China.
Standing on the Great Wall of China.
That's
I love
quite
it.
Have you got that on film? That must be
amazing.
Have.
I think you can YouTube that, actually.
YouTube it if you can.
And I've also played in the on the cruise liner going through the Yangtze River. It's really, really good fun.
So you've seen
people
a lot of
China. Yeah, I have.
And the Chinese love the trumpet, because it's not a Chinese instrument, is
they
it?
They do,
They're like bang, 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 Chinese, very twangy instruments.
Well, it's funny, Shane, because I do a number of pubs and chartered clubs in New Zealand, and what amazes me about the trumpet is that if you mix it with modern music as well, how many young people in New Zealand go, wow, because they've never heard it, and they just think it's really amazing. I mean, they've heard a trumpet, but not in a pub-type situation.
Yes. Yeah.
And it's quite interesting to see people who the least you would think would come up and say, hey, man, that was really good. These people coming forward saying really enjoyed that, you know.
That's the thing. horn sections and all that sort of thing. You don't see a lot of it in bands. Local bands are usually three guitars and a bass and
drums,
or a keyboard or whatever, a quartet.
Yeah.
And there's none of those, the odd sax.
Yeah.
But never much, not much of a trumpet.
Yeah.
And those days seem to have gone a bit. The big band sound. Roger Fox keeps it alive.
Mm.
And I remember in London seeing the big band experience for the first time. It absolutely blew me away. Trumpets and everything else going flat out,
that's
trombones.
Right.
Well, what an overpowering sound.
It is.
And
fun to sing in front of too, I'm sure.
Amazing.
Yeah.
I'm talking about Woody Herman and people like that. Like I said, I didn't see Eddie Calvert.
Right. Neither have I.
No, and we won't see him.
No.
He's long gone.
Still play his tunes though, so try and keep that alive.
So gig-wise, I mean, you're out there. It's quite difficult to sell a trumpeter.
It
so
is.
You work it as an entertaining thing.
That's right.
You know what I'm saying.
Yes, it is. And when you go into a club that they haven't heard you before and you say, I play the trumpet, and they go, oh, yeah, you know. But, I mean, I do a two and a quarter hour full show, a little bit of comedy, and I sing as well. And the main thing is to get people on the dance floor and getting up and enjoying it. You know, we don't want people just sitting and watching. We want them to get involved. Yeah. So,
Do you use a quartet, like a band behind
no,
you?
No, backing tracks generally. But do use bands sometimes, don't often get that that opportunity too much. But in fact, the last one I worked with, you'd know, Midnight Special.
Oh,
the Greaves team.
One of the best.
And they were fantastic. So I really enjoyed that.
Amazing band.
When you do that, it's quite exciting.
Must be good, No, they're a fantastic band.
Yeah.
Now, I know, just from where I get around, and I'm all over the place, and I see your name all over the place, John McGough, and your show's always being advertised wherever I go.
Yes.
So you're definitely getting around.
Yeah, so,
all the time.
And you know, you never know what's around the corner, do
you?
You never know from, it was only a couple of days ago and you was going to be here. So it's fantastic, you know. So I really do enjoy that. And I do a lot of the chartered clubs, as I say, and odd pubs and that around New Zealand, mainly in the North Island. I do a little bit of touring as well, but it gets so busy. Sometimes
you
don't know what's happening from one weekend to the next, you know.
Exactly, I know.
But, and I do MC work and that as well, so
you're an all-rounder.
All a bit of everything.
Anyway, John, You're going to play a beautiful trumpet piece for us now.
Yes.
Ably assisted by the other John on the show this
evening. Oh, yes. He's okay. Fantastic too, isn't he? Hey? Fantastic, yeah. JT.
So, where's this song from? It's called Shalala.
It is. I mean, it hasn't been that long ago we've had celebrated St. Patrick's Day for Ireland, just but this particular piece is for another island. It's for the floating islands in the Pacific.
I've seen a few of those. All right, here we are, John McGough with Shalala. McGough, and what a beautiful piece, and the other John.
JT, thank you, JT. Appreciate that. It was wonderful.
Fantastic. Yeah. And he just picked that up, walked into the studio and said, yeah,
didn't he?
For you.
How do you do that? Hey?
How do you do that? Yeah. Well, look, and I'm sure the two of you, it could be something special happening there. You two
might have to get down to Wynyard Quarter.
Couple of gigs. Yeah. All right. I'll get a little bit squashed for time, but I've got to ask you a difference. You've got two wonderful instruments. There's the trumpet.
There's the trumpet there, yes.
Okay. Now, next to it,
isn't she beautiful? Yeah, that's a flugelhorn.
She is flash.
It is lovely, isn't it?
And you call her a she, so they're always she.
That's right, yes.
Now, what's the difference there? It's still got three buttons.
Very mellow sound with this one. Can I play one quick note for you? Here we go. So we've got the trumpet. So that's quite sharp and raspy. Hear that? So a lot of... And people actually prefer that I play this one, Shane, because it covers up a lot more of my face.
No, they don't.
Yeah, it's true.
That's rubbish, I'm sure of it. Do you teach at all?
No, I don't, but I love it when the kids come up and they take interest in it. And it's often. If I've been able to inspire someone to start to learn, that's good enough for me.
Great. Well, look, go out there and get yourself a trumpet. Go down and see one of your local music shop and talk to them.
Too right.
And John, I've got to tell you, it's that time for Clip of the Week. And this week it's the Mockers.
Ladies and gentlemen, the Mockers.
Don't walk away from me, I'm not the kind that likes to be put down. Don't leave me standing here, I'm not the kind that likes to be the clown.
Without you, my life's gonna be forever Tuesday morning.
Fagan and the Lads, the Mockers. Of course, he was on The Beat Goes On just recently with a great interview. I must get him in on the show here on Rockin' the Planet.
Just before we go, though, John, where can we catch you singing?
Oh, as I say, playing and singing. We play at many of the chartered clubs around the country, right around the North Island. Probably best if you go on our gig guide, which is on the website, which is trumpetguy.co.nz.
Okay, trumpetguy.co.nz.
That's me.
Can't beat it, okay? And they've got gigs up there and everything else.
Too right.
And probably CDs and all that sort of thing. It's everything. Get in touch with John.
It's all there.
And he'll inspire you, I'm telling you.
We'll see you there.
Thank you so much, John, for being here. I really enjoyed myself. I learned so much about trumpets.
Well, I have too. Thank you for inviting me.
A pleasure.
Well, it's that time for Rockin' the Planet to move on over. I'm Shane. I'm so glad you could join me this week. We'll see you next week. Same time, same place. Until then, keep on rocking.